Hello, I'm A.F. Mixon, and on behalf of the English department, we'd like to introduce you to the 2023 recipient of the Hall Waters Prize, Terrance Hayes. Professor Hayes recently visited Troy and sat down with two students, Ashley Adams and Joshua Windus, to discuss his work and the state of poetry.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. My name is Ashley Adams, and this is
Joshua Windus.
And we are here with
Terrance Hayes.
Thank you so much for coming. We are here to ask you some questions,
sure.
So I'm just going to jump right in with my first one. Professor Hayes, can you tell us when in your life you discovered poetry, and specifically how your experience with Conve Condom in the mid-1990s inspired you?
Two interesting questions. When I discovered poetry is maybe sixth grade, just being able to write it in an English class. But not really thinking of it as a career, sort of like, when did you discover apple pie? You know, you just remembered at some point it being a thing you didn't want to stop doing. But certainly years later, by the time I was in my 20s, when I had an experience with this organization started by my professor at the time, Toy Derricotte, and another poet professor, Cornelius Eady, they started this organization called Cave Condom. Mm-hmm. At the time, there were about 30 students who were involved with it. Now it's maybe the whole student body is probably about 500 people, but there were about 30 people. I was there, but I was mostly as a kind of gopher. I was there making copies and running errands for people. So I still think of my career being one where I like to drift in that space between the teacher and the student, or the helper and the leader, and maybe even at the fringes of circles in general. So that was my earliest experience, and that was how it was formative. I just decided I never wanted to be in one room. Mm-hmm. Not the room of experimental, not the room of national, not the room of free verse, not the room of only telling stories, but sort of walking through a big house of poetry, sticking my nose in, standing for a minute and moving. Mm-hmm. So that would be how it influenced me, just opening up the world of poetry.
Amazing.
Oh, cool. So could you tell us a little bit about the poetry market? Do you come up with a title first and then come up with a collection of poems that match that, or do you come up with a collection of poems and then try to figure out the title?
So, you know, my real answer on that would be when my mother talks about what I do to her friends, the preacher, she says my son is a professor. And so if I think of my vocation as being teaching poetry and talking to people about poetry, I don't have to think about the market in that way. I prefer not to think of it as a thing that I have to sort of sell books to keep going. I have friends who make livings exclusively on their poetry, and I think they do fine. I just rather... maybe that's where my experimentation comes from, is that I don't have to think about who's going to buy it or who's going to understand it. I feel like if I have a handful of people who are interested, that's okay. I think I've been told I'm the leading seller at my publisher for contemporary poetry, but I just try not to think about that. And similarly, the way I think about prizes, I mostly am interested in the things that will generate the work. So anything in the marketplace that makes me write the next poem, which is not that much, but this, talking to you guys, traveling around, being stimulated by environments, those are the things that I do think of as like integral to writing poetry. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Even when you have to deal with bad peanuts on a plane.
It really is the bathroom on the plane that I can't
fit
into.
Oh, I see.
You know, I'll say that too. Because of my relationship to that, I try to travel maybe once. I do like hotels, so for the last 20 or 30 years, I've taken at least one poetry gig a month. Mm-hmm. Sometimes more. In Black History Month, I travel a little bit more. National Poetry Month. But generally, that one time a month, I take it as a vacation. Like, this is really my day off. I did something last week on a Sunday, and my friends were like, "You're working on a Sunday?" But I'm like, it's poetry. That's not work, you know. So I do think of it as all of it's great, even if getting there can be a challenge sometimes.
Yes, sir.
So have you thought of any ideas for poems while you're here?
Have I? Something did occur to me, and now I can't remember what it was. But yeah, there's been a few things.
Did it have somebody to do with the hotel. Color red?
The color red?
Yeah.
No. You know what, though? You just said it. It was the dirt.
Uh-huh.
The dirt in South Carolina is slightly oranger. It's like the Piedmont dirt is oxidation. So through Georgia, it's a little bit orange. Here, it's a little bit browner. So I was just thinking about blood in the dirt, mixing with things to get that color to be not quite as intense. Mm-hmm. So, you know, maybe that'll show up somewhere, but it's primarily just about the dirt and how great it is, you know, so mm-hmm. yeah, maybe.
Okay, this is my favorite question. Okay, as a Greek mythology lover myself, I noticed that you mentioned the mythological figure Orpheus in your 2006 poetry collection, Wind in a Box, and you even have a poem titled Cocktails with Orpheus. Mm-hmm. Can you please explain your connection to Orpheus and how you see classical mythology in general as a resource for your poetry?
Really good question. You know why? Because, so Orpheus is the king, prince of poets, so he shows up across everybody's work. There's certain poets that are like that, certain figures in mythology that are like that. Certainly Orpheus is a big one for references. So for a long time, I have, even in my first book, I have a poem called Noir Orpheus. He does show up. But in this last book, as I was thinking about Orpheus, I thought about this poem by another poet. I can't remember the name of the poet now, who has a poem about Eurydice, which is who, if you know the story, Orpheus, there's a bunch of stories about Orpheus, but one of the main ones is that he goes to the underworld to rescue Eurydice, and on the way coming back from the underworld, he's been told not to look, that she's behind him, and have that faith. And just as they're getting to the entrance out of the underworld, he looks over his shoulder, and then she's sucked back into the darkness. And I have been thinking that maybe Eurydice is a poet. You know, historically, through mythology, he is a figure. He goes and he has these adventures. He's heartbroken because he's lost his beloved and almost had her. But I'm like, she's the one who goes back to the darkness. She's going back to the desk. And she's the one who has to kind of rely on her imagination as opposed to his adventures on the Isle of Lesbos and all other things that happen for him after that. So I'm suggesting, like, even one kind of primary idea for a poet, it's nice to have another angle on that sometimes. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that shows up in that book is suggesting that maybe it's not Orpheus who is the poet, but Eurydice, the woman, the beloved, the muse, as she's sort of given to us in mythology. So hopefully a poem can do that. I can sort of, it gives me an opportunity to say this to you, like, maybe it's not Orpheus, it is Eurydice. Mm-hmm.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Ah, so I noticed there's a lot of just musical influences in your work. It's just undeniably there. And then there's also a lot of classical influences. And I was wondering, is it difficult to tie in all those different influences together, or does it just come just kind of naturally?
When I applied to graduate school, as an undergrad, you know, I wrote what I wanted. So I wrote essays, I read a whole bunch of stuff. Not, you know, just as I said, I didn't think people had careers at it. Even then, I thought maybe I'd be a college professor. Mm-hmm. So again, this is what I have become, it's what I always wanted to be. Meanwhile, with the work that I was reading, I just sort of wrote as I read. So when I applied to graduate school, it was before it was online, they still had dot matrix. You know what this is, little dot matrix printers. And so I filled out the form and it said, what do you want to have your degree in? And I wrote creative writing. And they put me in poetry. But I sent them short stories, essays, and poems, and I think they thought, looking at everything, that maybe poetry is what I should do. And so again, I think that that's partially right. And I still try to think of my relationship to work as a poet who can absorb all those genres. Mm-hmm. So I still will write kind of a little micro story sometimes, or something that maybe will sound like a song sometimes, little mythologies, little memoir things. So I think of the poet as being able to absorb all those genres. Certainly true for music, so that I don't think of myself in one corner of the music store, but as someone who can absorb it all and pretend to be it all and write about it all. So I think that's why they put me in poetry, because it is, to me, the most absorbent of all of the literary genres. But I still will say to you, though, probably a master's in creative writing or a graduate degree in creative writing is more liberating than a degree just in one genre. And so nobody's changed yet. Nobody believes that yet. But if you let me be in charge, everybody would be getting the same creative writing degree so that everybody could be poets and all the other things they want to be.
Do you have a record player?
I do. I do.
Okay.
A record player. I got a bunch of speakers. I got a bunch of mobile things that I carry around in the bathroom, little portable speakers. I do try to keep music going. And it is, you know, depends on what the music is for the day. I did a thing for the Paris Review, and I sent them, like, soundtracks for occasions. So I have, like, a 12-minute James Brown song that I play in the morning. I have a song I play when I'm walking, stuff I play when I'm working. So I do think of it as like a atmosphere, in fact, an easy way to get into a different zone. So it is always playing, yeah.
Yes, and I was looking on Amazon and I was looking at all kinds of record players.
So. Mm-hmm. Yeah, vinyl's back.
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So in your essay collection on Etheridge Knight, To Float in the Space Between, you write specifically how, though it does contain biographical elements, it is not a biograph, but rather a collection of essays as speculative, motley, and adrift as Knight himself. Can you explain a little more why and how the life and work of Etheridge Knight inspired you to write such a unique take on him?
Certainly. That even connects to what I was saying. I'm in undergrad. My freshman year in college. No one has seen my work, but I have shown my one professor, Dr. French, who was a Yankee and was down there because he raised horses and all kinds of crazy things. It was the 90s. I don't say his name now, so I shouldn't tell all of his proclivities. But he let me teach a couple of times when he wasn't in shape to teach. He's, you know, rest in peace. So that was my first experience with these things. And so he was the first professor I showed just a few poems. And anytime someone like me would come to campus, he would have me meet him. So I met with this one guy in October. This is actually a crazy story I haven't told in years. And so this guy was friends with Etheridge Knight. And I had read Etheridge Knight in my leisure time because he was a writer who had moved from Mississippi up to the Midwest. And he was a writer who seemed to be doing a lot of things. Sometimes he wrote haiku. Sometimes he wrote these weird fable poems. Sometimes he wrote political poems. Mm-hmm. And he had been in prison for 8 years. So my mother had been a prison guard, and a lot of my relatives had relationships with the prison system. So I thought that was someone I could connect with, really. And so I read him. I met this guy who happened to know him, and he said, over Christmas break, you should come and hang out with Etheridge Knight in Indiana. I think he had gotten out of prison at this point. And I thought about it, but I was like, this is in the book, you know. I was like, I don't know if I can tell my parents that I'm going to meet this guy. And it so happened, I don't think I put this part in the book, during the time I had off for school, I had a basketball tournament, and we went to NYU. It's my first Christmas basketball tournament. I like averaged 10 points a game. And we won the trophy. And I was like, I think that's okay that I didn't go. I'll go see Etheridge Knight during my spring break. And then he passed away in March. So between that moment and that moment, so I'm back at NYU years later. When I published my first book, years after that, I found this guy. And all of that sort of is the arc. That Etheridge Knight book is dedicated to this guy, Fran Quinn, who was, again, he was me. He just came to a campus, a small school. They probably couldn't afford Etheridge Knight at the time. He was just, he didn't even have a whole book. He just had a sheath of poems. But we sat in his office, and he was like, I think something's here. You should meet some poets. And then he lost track of me for 10 years until I found him and said, you know what? I did it. I'm still doing it. And so yeah, and then another 10 or 20 years when that book came out, I dedicated it to him. So I don't know if that answers it, but I would say the connection initially with Etheridge Knight was that, again, he was someone who seemed to not be on anybody's team. He was a black arts poet, he was a prison poet, he was a blues poet, he was a southern poet, he was a poet as a father, he was a poet who had addiction, so he just seemed to do whatever he wanted to do. And you know, that's very hard to find. If you look at the canon, if you look at any poet's style, it's hard to find people who are truly, truly, that's what I think of experimental, not that you're doing like, you know, a poem with a picture in it, a poem with one word in it, but that you are experimenting across fields. And so that just felt like a right, you know, the way I want it to be as a writer, as a creative writer. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
You have a lot of diverse influences in your work, and I'm kind of curious about how those inform your view of masculinity and how that's portrayed in your poetry.
I can give you a line from the sonnets. There's a line in one of the sonnets where it's like, Prince proves every man has a beautiful woman in him. Mm-hmm. So how you sort of manifest that is the idea that, like, yeah, you know, part of being masculine is being in touch with your feminine side, which I mean, I think you have to be if you're going to be a poet. But I wouldn't be able to say that for myself. I would say it for someone like Prince, who I also would say connected to like variety. I think, you know, Prince's capacity to be like falsetto and then like low sometimes, like that too seems useful for how we might think of masculinity or how we might think of being an artist. All the different hairstyles that he had over the course of his career, one way to think about character and personality. So I generally think of my interest in artists who aren't writers as still being really useful for how I think about writing. So Jay-Z is super important for like how business, Prince is important for this too, how you might be an artist inside a business. Michael Jordan is important for like, you know, you do want to kill people. So I was like, I got to kill my audience. You know, like the kind of excellence requires a kind of like, you know, mercilessness with the art. And so, I mean, I could think of across the genres. Picasso is a person like that. Jimi Hendrix is a person like that. Toni Morrison, James Baldwin. So I think I'm often thinking about just people who have a certain kind of liberty and freedom inside of their work, and then trying to just use that for my own craft.
Okay, so Professor Hayes, you write on page 6 of American Sonnet from My Past and Future Assassin, "Inside me is a black-eyed animal bracing in a small stall." Do you still feel as though you're an animal trapped in a small space? Is your body that small stall, and has your mind freed you from confinement?
Again, good question. So I think about duality. I talked about this today on the stage, that sometimes I'm doing this gesture, and then, you know, in the middle is where we are, but there's this position, and then there's that position. So I do think of, in that poem even, I'm thinking about like where personality comes from. So part of that poem is sort of suggesting that my father is kind of a bull, very rooted. He's the black-eyed bull in a stall. Mm-hmm. And then my mother's sort of like a bird image. So she wants to fly, but she's sort of in this cage. And so I remember how that poem ends. Would you rather like be lifting off even if you were in a cage, or would you rather be rooted in the earth even if you were in a stall? And I think of, again, my personality is probably like that. Part of it is certainly like a bird trying to always break free and get up high as I can, and then part of it is like wanting to be like a bull down in the earth, being reliable and sort of stable. So that's really what that poem is exploring. And so I think that it connects to the poems themselves, but more so, if I say sometimes like many memoirs, but poetry allows it to be disguised in a certain kind of way. For me, that's what I think about. That's a poem to me about like the influence of my parents or my personality.
See, yeah. I read Wind in a Box, mm-hmm. and you talked a lot about your childhood in that one.
Right.
So when I read The Black-Eyed Animal, I did picture your father as the bull and your mother as the bird. I
Absolutely.
Saw that completely. But for you, I saw you as a horse.
Well, interesting. Yeah, yeah. People have said that too. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking about, again, like whatever it is, what would be between a bird and a bull? I got to draw that up tonight. An animal that's part bird, part bull. But I'm really saying something else. Like in between that space, there's zones for the muscularity of the horse, or the quietness of the cat, or the shyness of the cricket. You know, today I read a poem about the tree frog even. So I'm thinking about our relationship to like spirit creatures. But I will still say to you though, as I said today about like the 6 sides to any answer, every question has a 6-sided answer to it. Here too, I still would do this. Like I'm neither and both at the same time, and probably most of us are like that. We're neither and both our parents. We're denying certain parts of the way our parents have influenced us, but they're there nonetheless. So that would be probably right. So I wouldn't even say like firmly horse. Some days, Thursday I'm a horse, and on Fridays I'm a cat. You know, it's that kind of thing. Yeah.
You mentioned frogs a lot. I wonder if it's that neither land or water aspect of frogs.
Yeah, I do like the frogs. See, now I'm going to tell my story, and if my mother ever sees it, she's like, are you still telling people that story? I did have a Kermit the Frog doll, and I think if I had had that through my whole childhood, who knows if I would have been an artist. But I was 6, and my mom was 22 at the time, and I broke a vase that had something like that in it, and in her rage, she cut up my Kermit the Frog doll. And this doll I took everywhere. I took it in the tub. It was my primary toy. And so the thing I said about her being 22 is trying to give her a little bit of room for, you know, what is it like to be 22-year-old with a 6-year-old son? Mm-hmm. So, but my dad and my brother and my aunt and my grandmother, and as you see me now, it does come up. So it's always a thing that is probably one of her deepest regrets, that she, you know, why you cut up that boy's doll? But it was a frog. It was the Kermit the Frog doll. And so.
I had a teddy bear.
Yeah.
So I understand.
What I would say to writers is that, like, those things do become symbols. Like, I don't necessarily have to write a poem that's exclusively narrative to my relationship to Kermit the Frog necessarily, but the frog, like the bird or the bull, they just become, if you allow them to be what, you know, sort of more open that way, they can resonate across different ways for people. So I don't have to, like, I talk to my students about this, police you in your understanding of the poems and say like, no, this means that, and this means that. I can say like, oh, you know, bulls mean different things, horses mean different things, frogs mean different things.
Kind of accepting a plethora of meanings.
Yeah, and that is the benefit of like image. Like if you let your image be what it is, it will resonate. I think that's true for color too. You don't have to own blue. You can be like, if you put blue in it, some people think it's melancholy, some people think it's the sky, and you're sort of like happy for that, because as you say that, I think, yeah, certainly, you know, land and water is probably the same relationship as the bull and the bird in a kind of way, so I have to think about that later. So yeah.
I really find it interesting how your work deals with gender expectations. Yeah. There's one line that sticks out, quote, you talk about black girls who hold their own hands.
Right.
What inspired that line?
You remember the next line after that? It's like the white boys who were assassins too. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of a high school poem and thinking about, like, I guess my personality, and it would still be this. I don't really, even the notion of the assassin in the book, I think mm-hmm. that's the gesture of the book. Mm-hmm. I'm not really like a vengeance person necessarily. Mm-hmm. So whatever we think of like the wake of American history, mm-hmm. I sort of feel like it's better for me to think of it in a kind of, there's a person from Alabama, Ruby Sales, who not that many people know about. She's like a philosopher and a mm-hmm. theologian who talks about like redemption in terms mm-hmm. of how you deal with mm-hmm. pain or mm-hmm. injury. You could think about what I just said about my mother. Like there's a way that I could let that be a central mm-hmm. kind of damage or trauma. And I was like, it probably is in some ways, but I'd rather think of it in terms of like, well, she was 22. Like, mm-hmm. how responsible can any 22-year-old be for their actions sometimes, you know? So I would say, like, mostly I'm often trying to have an attitude towards things that are not, violence even would be too extreme. It's just like, and judgment wouldn't be right either, but I think you hear what I'm saying. Like, I start thinking about, like, Doctor Who and, like, kindness.
Can you describe it as catharsis, or is that not quite strong enough?
You know what? I have a line in the poem. The line of one of the poems I read today, the deeper the wound, the more heroic the healing. Mm-hmm. Certainly that would be central for me as a kind of through line for that book, because I'm sort of saying, like, clearly people are going to do damage to you in any kind of way you want to think about sexism, racism, your family, random things. And it's sort of like, if you can get over any of those kinds of traumas or wounds, you know, it's heroic. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you're regular. That's fine. No shade if you can't recover from certain kinds of injuries. But we know the people who recover from really deep injuries are heroes. And so that's what I would aspire to, not necessarily to villainize people. And you know, I'm talking in a very broad way this mm-hmm. way. So that's why I would say that line about girls holding their hands, and why I would add the next line about mm-hmm. they come together at the end of the poem, which is like, even the white boys who are assassins, I still think of in the same gesture of like holding each other's hands or me holding their hands. There's another poem in the book where, again, more biographical poem, where there was a kid who was a bully, and clearly, you know, again, even the word like this high school seems like too extreme, but clearly like a racist. He hadn't worked his stuff out yet. And so all of my friends, black, some girls, they are always sort of gunning for him. And I can remember an instance where like people got at him, and then I found out years later that he passed away in a random accident. And the last line of that poem is like, I'm still sorry I didn't go to that white boy's funeral, you know, like that is a thing. That's where my energy goes, not to the dwelling of like I can explain, as I said, probably some of the actions, but it's more interesting to me to kind of get to the place where I'd be like, man, you know, I didn't know that dude died. I should have went to his funeral, regardless of, you know, what he was like on the ground. So, I don't know if it's catharsis. I think it's still tied up in it's just more productive, I think. It's just better to think of the possibility of like getting over that stuff. I mean, even forgiveness is a mm-hmm. tricky word in that regard. And another poem, I have a line of capacity for love without forgiveness. You know, that's an interesting exercise. So that's what I would say the work is trying to give me usually, whether we're talking about family or history or strangers on the street, some way to kind of like, you know, if you can get over this, it's better than if you can't. Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah. You should be on more talk shows.
Thank you.
Okay. So one of your collections is called How to Be Drawn, and your website features a great deal of your original artwork. How do you see your work as a visual artist informing your poetry and vice versa?
I think the next book is going to sort of play with that. This prose book that comes out with the book of poetry called Watch Your Language. And I would say I've always drawn. If you went back to my school, I mean, I never know how this stuff sounds like, but you know, like when I graduated from high school, anybody that knows me, if they were seeing this, they would be saying, oh, we thought Terrance was gonna be a painter. And I was good. I painted like the school murals and school t-shirts. One time I got arrested and I painted a judge, and that got me out of it. So people definitely knew that that's what I could do. And on the last day of school, when I was like throwing out art from my art studio, my coach and teachers came around and was taking it. And so everybody was convinced that if I was ever going to be in a position like this, it would be as a painter. I just couldn't afford it. You know, like I liked oil paints and I liked big canvases. And so I knew in my life, I wouldn't be able to do it until I got where I am now, where I can, you know, paint. In the meantime, I just sort of absorbed the gesture of visual art as a way of writing. So when I say to you, oh, I got to draw a bird part bull tonight, and then maybe a poem will come, but the first thing I would do is try to draw something like that and play around with it and think about it while I was drawing it. Mm-hmm. So writing for a long time has been connected to a kind of drawing. And I would just say now at this point in my career, I'm just at a place where somebody would let me do that. But even 10 years ago, if I had pitched to anybody that I wanted to do a book with drawings and prose in it, they'd be like, that doesn't exist. And even now, the thing that I'm bringing out maybe isn't, it's not a graphic novel, you know, it's still a thing that I've never seen before, because again, the writing is like pictures of artists and essays sketched out, and I have a visual timeline of like the history of poetry and, you know, everybody I've ever liked I've drawn in this thing. And so I guess that would be the answer. I still think of visual arts as very much a part of my life, but not necessarily the professional part, just a part of this generative, and it'll be interesting to have that be, you know, a book now. Yeah.
Thank you.
There's a very strong emphasis on the father-son relationship.
Sure.
In your work. I was just curious what your thoughts are or what experiences you've had with father figures or masculine role models.
Right. When I started trying to figure out who my real father was, man, that was like hip logic. So that's, we're talking maybe 2001, 2002. Mm-hmm. My stepfather, who's been there since I was four, was taken aback by it a little bit. There's new work still thinking about this question, but I'm like, this is what we have in common. My mother had me when she was very young, his mother had him when he was very young, and he didn't know his dad. You met him once or twice. Same for me, I met my dad twice. So I kept trying to talk to him about that really being a separate kind of issue for me, that question about like biology and the question of like my father. But the reason I went to look for him in that second book is that I was afraid I was going to keep writing about it. I was like, if I don't find my actual father, I will keep writing about who is my daddy. And so it was really, in a really weird way, a way to grow as a writer and not be stuck around subject. I did find him purely on that reason. And then, you know, he's an interesting guy. And I still write about it. I actually met some family members, some brothers. I said to someone today that I have this poem under my bed that I started writing early on, and I haven't finished it yet because I think I probably got to find my brothers again to finish it. So that is to say, like, yeah, it's there in various kinds of ways. But the last thing I'll say to you, how I've embraced it, and this is still about perspective, is that I'm a very proud bastard. You know, like a bastard means you can draw from everything. And really, the bastard is a tradition of America. Like, we all have some question of our legacy and what that means and whether we should be proud of it. So I embrace that as part of my identity, having more than one dad.
You give such beautiful answers.
Thank you.
And I would love to see more of your art.
Yeah, it's online, and it'll be in the book. It'll be in this book that comes out in July.
That's
it'll
very
be a lot
exciting.
Of, a lot of drawings. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
Well, it looks like we're winding down, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's been good to talk to y'all.
Thank
really
you
great being able to have you here, and thank you for our audience.